Okay, this is PC building channel, so what the heck am I doing with a laptop here? Well, in addition to all the desktop building that I do, as you might have noticed, I actually do edit a fair bit of video. So I am checking out the M1 Pro today, and we'll do a little studio talk. We'll compare it against the Hackintosh build that I have here in my NCase M1 for final cut performance. So today let's compare M1 to M1 and Apples to... long two machines and more. I game on a PC, duh, and I prefer Windows heavily for just about everything in general, except for one thing, and it's kind of a big thing. I edit my videos in Final Cut. I learned how to do video editing about 15 years ago in Final Cut 7, but I switched over to 10 when it first came out, and that's been my analy of choice. I'm a sucker for the magnetic timeline, and it just works for the way I shoot and edit the videos here for the channel, and especially for that content on this channel. It saves a lot of time. I have tried the workflow in DaVinci Resolve before, and sure, if this were a Hollywood production, it might make sense, but for YouTube, Final Cut is perfect for me and it's quick. Problem is, it's macOS specific and there's really no way around it. Now, I've built my fair share of Hackintoshes to run it. The one over here is my latest one, the M1. It's a dual boot open core system, 5600 XT, 10700K, 32 gigs of RAM. And that configuration is pretty similar to one of the previous gen Intel iMacs. Of course, this is a full on desktop GPU with a larger cooler. Now, this laptop here is the base model M1 Pro. 8 cores with a 6P plus 2E setup, 16 gigs of unified RAM. It's as base as it gets, right? And I'm checking it out today to see if how it stacks up. I haven't decided if I'm gonna use one of these yet, but I wanted to see if this would actually make sense for my video editing. Now, I do have this on the Cooler Master Connect stand that they sent by. Thanks, guys. It even has a sickle flow fan attached to it, see? But I'm not sure I'll even need that. But it's nice to know that at least there's the option. So based on the Geekbench 5 scores, this should be pretty comparable. The M1 Pro is more competitive than the 10700K that I have in the NCase, but this one has a discrete GPU, right, in the 5600 XT. So I set up a simple test with a timeline. I shoot with a Sony FX3 in 4K 422 10-bit. Footage is logged in XAVCHS, which is a very punishing codec, especially in 120fps, since HEVC is heavily compressed. So let's take a quick look at 120fps from the 6600 XT review. Yeah, plays back just fine here. This is not transcoded to ProRes, just stock out of the camera. Pretty impressive. And then over to the Hackintosh. Take a look here. Oh. Video frames were dropped during playback, so it stutters and it can't keep up with the 120fps. So that's why I usually transcode to ProRes on the Hackintosh in order to get it to playback fine. And that's exactly why. It can't do it without stuttering. Now, this is a pretty optimized open core setup though. Even though you do need to pick a suitable SM BIOS, I have tested quite a few, and this one is using the iMac Pro 1.1, which doesn't use the iGPU in the 10700K, but set up this way, it makes proper use of that discrete GPU, and it does run quite well otherwise. So, okay, say it doesn't play back smoothly, then you'd need to transcode that footage to ProRes. How does that look? Well, the M1 Pro has a dedicated ProRes encoder and decoder, and that is why it is so fast. And the Hackintosh has to use the CPU for that task. The 10700K is full throttle here. I'm not sure about the regular M1 I borrowed to get that benchmark, but yeah, it's gotta have some dedicated hardware too for that, since the CPU isn't gonna beat out the 10700K. A couple of the other things you might do in Final Cut, you might stabilize your footage. The M1 Pro here is, as I tested, faster here by a little bit. So object track is a new function in the latest version of Final Cut. Let's just take a look here. We'll just click analyze in both directions. We're just gonna go forward and start these two off. I've already tested it, but the Hackintosh is zipping along just a little bit faster than the M1 and M1 Pro. And what it's doing is it's trying to track the same shape or pattern in the footage. And that gets delegated to the discrete GPU. So that's Hackintosh is already finished, and this just finished. So the Hackintosh does win by a little bit there. And that's because of the discrete GPU giving the Hackintosh a leg up. Now, when it comes time to export that timeline, the AMD GPU has a dedicated hardware encoder for H.264. So when the discrete GPU can shine, the Hackintosh is pretty awesome. When we export to a ProRes file though, the M1 Pro with its dedicated hardware is pretty unbeatable. Now if you work that way, you still have to encode with something like Handbrake to get to H.264. And there you'll see a similar gap between these two machines. I was interested in power consumption for various tasks, and that is one area that the ARM chip just blows the desktop out of the water. Now keep in mind, this is with a display being powered too, you know, the laptop. So yeah, there are some areas that the Hackintosh does better, but so far I'm actually pretty impressed by the M1 Pro. At least from a workflow perspective, where I'm waiting to edit my footage, this thing is gonna save a lot of time, not to mention I might not really even need to transcode it with this guy. I am still deliberating it though. I do like the idea so far. Yeah, I could upgrade the GPU in the NCase M1 to a 6800 or 6800 XT, but in the GPU market right now, I don't know that that makes too much sense. And for the tasks that the GPU can do, the 5600 XT is already better anyway. Now, the one thing that is giving me some pause is that support for the 6600 XT is gonna be there in Monterey 12.1. I already have a 6600 XT, so that does give me a little pause. I kind of want to see how it performs with that. But specifically for my workflow in Final Cut, this thing is pretty sweet. It's mobile. Yeah, it's a laptop. I can't upgrade the RAM if I wanted to later on, but otherwise it's pretty killer. The screen is gorgeous. The build quality is great. The keyboard, it's actually one of the nicest laptop keyboards that I've typed on before. The speakers are incredible. Pretty impressed, but of course the HDMI port, it's totally half-assed. Yeah, okay, pat yourself on the back for bringing back something that you killed off, but then it's only a 2.0 port, whatever. We'll see what happens. I'll keep you guys updated. Thanks for checking it out with me. Give a like if you enjoyed it. Links are down below. Subscribe and see you again soon.